gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, you know what time it is? It's time to worship God. So welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon Water and Home Church. Get ready to be blessed. So sit back, hang on, enjoy the ride as we take you out of this crazy world and into a spirit-filled, life-changing gospel show service. Already in progress.
How's that? Ah, a microphone's working. Got to remember, your microphone needs to be turned on if you want it to work, oddly enough. Anyway, welcome everybody to Salvation Saloon, Water and Hole Church. We are so glad to see you here today because we're gonna praise the Lord and we're going to have a really good time doing it because that's how we do business here. So I hope you're here to have some fun and praise Jesus. What do you say?
Amen.
All right.
You gotta move. You gotta move. You gotta move, child. You gotta move. When the Lord gets ready, you gotta move. You gotta move, child. You gotta move. Yes.
Yeah, that's the way to wake up on a Sunday morning, huh? Well, this song has been around with us for a while, and it's a song I wrote several years ago, and I'll tell you a little bit of story about this one. When we first did the first time I started with going to the saloon, we were down here at the, I forget what it was called at the time, down the road here on 19, but, you know, it was a curiosity, right, because there's lots of bikes there, lots of guys dressed up, you know, biker gear and stuff, and, you know, we had a big sign out front, you know, church services and so on and so forth. And one day, this lady came up to me, and she wanted to maybe make a point that, you know, we might not have been a real church, you know. So she comes up, she says, well, what is this? I don't understand. I said, oh, this, we have a church service here. It's called Salvation Saloon. She said, in a bar? I said, yeah, in a bar. She said, well, you serve drinks? I said, well, we don't serve alcoholic drinks, but we serve the living water. Yeah. So I think I made the point, right?
Amen.
Anyhow, so... So that's the story behind this song, right?
Amen.
A Living Water.
Water,
living water.
You gotta
Okay, well, this is a brand new song for us. And we
It's pretty did, old, Dave. It's
well,
pretty
it's a new
old.
Song for, that's why I qualified for us. We're slow learners, okay? It's been
You're
out
right.
a long time, but
right.
we're slow learners.
But it's a great, great song.
Yes,
it's
it is.
What we need to do. When we drink that living water, we also need to trade our sorrows, trade our shame for His living water.
I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord. And I say,
yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
And I say,
yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.
Persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed, blessed beyond the curse, for the promise will endure, that His joy is gonna be my strength.
Through the sorrow may last for the night,
His joy comes in the morning. Yes,
All right. Good job, Nitty Gritty Church Band. Hey, welcome, everyone. Welcome to Happy Hour at the world famous Salvation Saloon. For those of you who may be here for the very first time, I'm not sure if there is any of you guys out there. But if you are here, we always start our services out by letting you guys know we are so glad you guys are here. We truly believe God's going to bless you. There is one thing we would ask, though, and that is if you would grab one of these little yellow cards that you see all over the place, and if you would, just throw your name in that, tell us where you're from, that'd be cool. But then if you don't mind, if you just hold on this card till the end of the service and write down the bottom in the comment section, if you tell us what you thought, we'd appreciate that because we're always kind of curious. So if you do that, that would be great. Be a bucket by the door. You can drop this card in that bucket on your way out. But again, welcome to the Salvation Saloon. You are our guest, so from here on out, sit back, hang on, enjoy the ride. Everybody else knows, though, that we have some other purposes for this card, and that is if there happens to be a birthday or an anniversary, it could be just about anything that you think we got to know about, you can put it on this card 1 week in advance. But the main reason we have these cards is for prayer. So if you're here and you have a need in your life, put that need down on this card and give God an opportunity to show himself strong, because prayer does work. Amen? This is what the Bible tells us. The Bible tells that our God is a present help in times of trouble, but also tells us sometimes we have not because we ask not. So again, put your needs down on this card. All right, here at the Salvation Saloon, we are a family. Like every family, we try to make sure we recognize each other. And by gory, I believe we got a saloontic birthday, don't we, Rob?
Hey! Come on!
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
All right. Happy birthday, Jerry Ann and George. And there is a game we play each and every week. Name of that game is Name That Saloonatic. If you are here for the first time, just so you know, we do call our congregation members Saloonatics. And every week what we do is we try to get a picture, an old picture, and we throw it up, and we try to guess who it is. So see what you can do with this. See if you can tell me who this Saloonatic is. Dave George. All right. Well, let's find out. Will the real Saloonatic please stand up near the back? It's Carol Harris. Very good. All right. Well, moving right along. That is all I have today. So we need to continue on. We need to do things the right way. So I'm going to get Jason, who has finally made it, made his move from beautiful downtown Bucksport, Maine, to Florida and to the Salvation Saloon. And I told him if he came down, I was going to put him to work. And so here he is. Why don't you open up in prayer for us, bro?
It is good to be here. It's good to see you guys. And we are so happy to be here, even though it is hot if you're from Maine. If you want any idea of what we're going through, go home, climb into your oven. I climb into a refrigerator for 47 years, then get out and get into the oven. And that's kind of what I'm going through at the present moment. I have this nice look where I have this sweat stain right here. But God bless air conditioning. We've been very blessed. Some people don't have that. I'm going to get right into it. I'm going to take my hat off. You do not have to take your hat off. God does not care where your hat is. He cares where your heart is. My mother cares, and I know you're going to watch this. So, Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity to get together. Whether you traveled 1,500 feet or 1,500 miles, thank you for the safety in our travels. May we get what we need from the sermon that's been prepared, and bless this offering, bless the gift and the giver. Amen.
It was so good to see you, and so good job
from a mother's heart. Good job.
Yeah, mamas yes. have some sway around here.
Absolutely. Ready?
Yes.
James a prison, as cruel as a grave. Shame is a robber, and he's come to take my name. Love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. Love is the power where my freedom song is found. One more time. Shame is a prison, as cruel as a grave. Shame is a robber, and it's come to take my name. Love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. Love is the power where my freedom song is found. There ain't no graves gonna hold my body down. There ain't no graves gonna hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, velvet tongue. Fear is a tyrant, always telling me to run. Love is resurrection, love is a trumpet sound. Love is my weapon, I'm gonna take my giants down. There ain't no grave, it's gonna hold my. Thank you. If you walk out of the grave, I'm a walking too. If you walk out of the grave, I'm a walking too. Hey, hey. If you walk out of the grave, I'm a walking too.
I love that one. All right. Well, let's study God's Word. And what we've been doing, we have been following the life of Jesus by way of Luke's Gospel. And today, as we begin chapter 11, Jesus is now at the end of his earthly ministry, which means there is a cross on the horizon that has his name on it. And yet, knowing what lies ahead, Jesus has willingly set his sights on Jerusalem and that cross, because hanging on that cross is going to be the hope of all mankind. Amen? As Jesus is about to fulfill his messianic mission as the Lamb of God who has come to take away the sin of the world. Now, although Jesus has made his soon departure known to his disciples, they still can't seem to really comprehend it. But what we've been seeing is we've been seeing that Jesus has been spending a lot more time with them, so that when he does leave, well, they will be prepared to carry on the mission that he had started. Now, earlier in Luke chapter 5, Jesus was questioned, right? He was questioned as to why his disciples were not praying and fasting like John's disciples or like the disciples of the Pharisees. But Jesus answered them by saying this. Jesus said, "Can you make the friends of the bridegroom fast and pray while he is with them? But the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them. And in those days, they will then need to fast and pray." So, as Jesus is about to be taken from them, well, they're going to need to be educated on prayer. And in verse 1, the door for that education is opened when it says this. When one day as Jesus was praying in a certain place, well, when he had finished, one of his disciples said, "Lord, teach us to pray just as John taught his disciples." So, apparently, they were well aware that this was something that, you know, they were missing out on, right? Because, again, they saw Jesus, right? And they saw that prayer was very important to him. And so if it was important to Jesus and also important to everyone else's disciples, well, I guess that they also realized that they needed to get with the program. And with that, well, Let's welcome the disciples to Prayer 101 as Jesus is about to lay on them the Lord's Prayer. All right, the Lord's Prayer. Most everyone is familiar with this prayer, right? And most everyone has also memorized this prayer and quoted this prayer, and many will quote it on a regular basis. But here's the thing. Jesus didn't give us the Lord's Prayer so that we would quote it over and over and over again in some mechanical fashion, because prayer is not a chant, right? It's not a chant, or it's not some verbal ritual that we rattle off in some mechanical fashion, or in some meaning as like some meaningless obligation. But instead, prayer is communication, right? Prayer is dialogue where we share our thoughts and our feelings. And to simply define it, prayer is basically a personal conversation with God. Amen? It's a conversation with God. So there's really nothing hard about it, right? I mean, it's something that, you know, even a child can do. But there are certain things that will make a prayer more effective, and there are certain things and content that our prayer should contain. And so what Jesus is about to do is he is basically about to lay out a template for prayer, or provide them with basically what this is the a prayer model, right? The model prayer. And so in verse 2, this is what Jesus says to them. He says, when you pray, say this, right? Or more accurately, as Matthew quoted Jesus in his account of the Lord's Prayer, well, it's pray in this manner. Pray in this manner. So, again, Jesus is about to give them a template or a basic prayer guide. And the first step is to address our God, right? And we're to address him as Father, as Father. So there it is, right there. Prayer is meant to be personal, right? It's meant to be personal. And to address our God as our Father, well, that certainly describes a relationship, right? And as we know, the relationship between a father and his children, I mean, that is something that is very close and very personal. And then, well, Father is to be followed by hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. That's respect and honor, right? That's the respect and honor that our God and Father deserves. And that sets our Father apart from any other, right? Because really, there is no other Father like ours. Amen? And then we're to pray this. We're to pray for our Father's kingdom to come. Now, the ancient Jews used to say, he who prays without mentioning that kingdom that God had promised, then they're not praying at all. Right? Because it is important. It's important to long for the arrival of our Father's kingdom. Because that kingdom, right, that he had promised, well, it's not going to come cheap. It's not going to come cheap, but it's going to come at the expense of his own son. And so just as the Bible tells us, right, we were bought with a price. We were bought with a price. And that price, that deserves our respect and honor, right? Because for a God who so loved the world, right, that he would send his son, send us Jesus to lay down his life in our place, well, that's a love that can't be denied. Amen? That's a love that cannot be denied. Now, in Matthew, again, right, where we do have a little more detailed account of this prayer, well, it's there that it says, you know, not only your kingdom come, but Matthew also adds, and your will be done. Right? So that's God's will and not ours. Amen? God's will and not ours. Because God, he is not our personal genie where our wish is his command. Right? And so by praying for his will, well, what we're saying is, Lord, you direct my life. You direct my life. Okay? Exactly as it says in Proverbs chapter 3, when it states there that we are to acknowledge the Lord in all our ways, and he will then direct our steps. All right. Well, let's be honest. A lot of times we accept God's will in some areas, but not in others. But here's the deal, right? God wants to be Lord in every area of our lives. Every area of our lives, right? And not because our God is a dictator and wants to control us, because he has given us the freedom to choose. But he wants us to submit to his will because he simply knows what's best for us. Amen? And so, what we see as this model prayer begins is we see that it begins with God, right? It's his name, his kingdom, and his will, right? But also notice this, right? And that is to be able to say, our Father, well, that requires faith, right? Because the Bible also tells us that he who comes to God must believe that he is, right? And to pray, your kingdom come, that requires hope. And to pray, your will be done, that requires love, right? Because it's love and respect that fuels our desire to then obey our God and Father. And so we see as prayer begins, begins with this focus on God, well, it is that focus and submission that establishes a very personal relationship. But now that we've covered God's interest, well, in verse 3, well, it's also appropriate to pray for our own interests, right? Such as this, verse 3, give us each day our daily bread, right? Or give us each day our daily necessities. And what would that be? Well, that would be like food and clothing, the ability to pay our bills, right? But notice this, right? Notice it doesn't say provide my needs beyond today, but it's day by day, right? And there's a reason for that. It's day by day because God wants us to be continually relying and trusting on him, right? And just like we saw a few chapters back when Jesus sent his disciples out to evangelize, because how did he do that? Well, he sent them out with nothing, right? With nothing, with no food, with no money. But what were the results of that? The results of that were that they were basically forced to then be dependent on God. Amen? So there's a reason for that. Now, bread may be the number one need of our physical bodies, but verse 4 is about to give us our number one spiritual need. And that would be to ask God to forgive us of our sins. Forgive us of our sins. I think that's a given, right? I think we all know here that we constantly fall short and we need to be forgiven. But then there's actually a second part that's attached. And that would be that we're also to forgive everyone who sins against us. All right. I think we'd all agree that forgiveness, man, that's a beautiful word, isn't it? Forgiveness is a beautiful word. But you know, it's not quite so beautiful when it happens to be us who needs to forgive, though. Don't know if you've noticed that. I have. Because then suddenly, it's a rather unappetizing word, right? It is a hard word. But here is why it is so necessary. And that is because of what Jesus had to say in Mark chapter 11. And that is this. Jesus said, whenever you stand praying, forgive. Forgive if you have anything against anyone, so that your Father in heaven will also forgive you. But if you will not forgive others, then neither will your Father forgive you. So yeah, that's important, right? It's important because our forgiveness is actually predicated by our forgiveness of others. Now, if you remember a few chapters back, remember in Luke chapter 6, Jesus told us there to be merciful just as our Heavenly Father is merciful to us, right? He told us to be merciful just as our Heavenly Father is merciful to us. So if God is willing to forgive all of us of all our sins, then who are we to then turn around and refuse to forgive the few sins of the other people around us, right? And yet, I have heard more than once from people who profess to be Christians, right, that have said this, right? I've heard people say, I do not care what the Bible says because I will never forgive that person for what they did to me. Well, let me tell you this, right? You do not reject God's commands, and you don't take for granted, right, the sacrifice of Christ and not get called on it, right? Because be not deceived, God is not mocked, And whatever a man sows, that will he also reap. Right? So if we sow unforgiveness, we're going to reap unforgiveness. And I'm thinking that's a pretty heavy price to pay for a bunch of stubborn pride. Amen? So, I don't know about you, but as for me, I'm going to embrace God's grace. And I'm going to embrace God's grace because I need God's grace. Now, does that mean I'm just wimping out? Does that mean I'm like some religious Marvin Milquetoast who just allows everyone to just walk all over me? Not at all. Right? Because guess what? My God's got my back. Right? Because just as it states in Romans chapter 11, it's God's job and not our job to repay evil for evil. And we can trust in him to do that. Trust in him to avenge us. Because what does the Bible also say there in chapter 12? It says that vengeance is mine, says the Lord, and I will repay. And so if you think about it, why in the world should we be carrying around all this anger and all this resentment and allow our lives to be just confused with all this conflict when it's God who says that he wants us to cast all our cares and concerns on him? And if we do that, he said he will sustain us and he will never allow us to be shaken. Amen? All right, let me give you a couple other Bible verses to stand on. Like when in Isaiah it says this, says that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Because every tongue that rises against us, our God will condemn. Or as it says in the Psalms, there's actually two verses I'm putting together here. It says, by God's faithfulness to his children, right? God's faithfulness to us, he will bring destruction on our enemies. And our accusers will perish in shame, and those who want to harm us will be covered in disgrace. So who knows, right? If we do it the right way and allow God to deal with it, then maybe, right, just maybe his vengeance just might serve to encourage some repentance in some people that will then lead to their salvation. Because for anyone who tries to fight against God, well, there's only one sensible conclusion to that, right? And that has got to be, well, if you can't beat him, might as well join him. Amen? Can't beat him, join him. All right, moving on from there. Jesus also says to add this to our prayers, and that is, Jesus, lead us, we're to ask the Father, lead us not into temptation. Matthew also adds to that, but deliver us from evil, right? Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. All right, that is asking God to keep us and to protect us from the opportunity to sin, right? And you know what? God will do that. God will do that, right? He will keep the opportunity of sin from chasing us down, although it's not going to apply if we're choosing to chase sin down. It's not going to apply then. Because again, that's where our freedom of choice kind of plays in. But that freedom of choice is also followed very closely by that spiritual law that says we'll reap what we sow. And here's how that works. You sow foolish and unwise choices, you're going to reap the benefits of those foolish and unwise choices. And what's that mean? It means life's going to suck. All right? It means life's going to suck. But on the flip side, if we live a life that sows wise and godly choices, then we're going to reap the benefits of those wise and godly choices. And what does that mean? It means life's going to be good. Life's going to be good. And there it is. That is Luke's kind of abbreviated version, but Luke's version of the Lord's Prayer. But now, as we continue on from there, we're going to remain on the subject of prayer, or Jesus is going to remain on the subject of prayer. And it's in verse 5. That it tells us this. It tells us that Jesus then said this to them. He said, suppose you have a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. Because in verse 6, a friend of mine on a journey has come to me, and I have no food to offer him. But in verse 7, suppose the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door is already locked, and my children and I are in bed, so I can't get up and give you anything. Now, I think we know this. I think we know that in this day, hospitality was a very important thing, right, to these people. And whenever someone would visit, then they were obligated to provide them with food, right? And as a sign of that hospitality, what people used to do back then, they used to leave their doors wide open all day long. But when the day was done, right, and the whole family was then in their little one-room house for the night, well, that's when the door would then be shut, and that was also a sign. That was a sign that the time for hospitality was now over, right? Because then you got all the family members. They're going to be inside. They're going to lay out their mats on the floor where they're going to sleep. Also, most likely, there's going to be some animals in there with them. And so if someone does come, you know, late and starts knocking on the door, well, all those animals are going to start squawking. They're going to start making, you know, all this noise, and it's going to wake everyone up, right? It's going to disturb the whole household. But Jesus says this in verse 8. He says, I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, so kind of like, you know, hey, we'll be friends tomorrow, but I'm not going to be your friend right now. But yet, because of your shameless audacity, right, your persistence, well, it says that he will surely get up and he will give that person as much as they need. And basically, they'll do that, I mean, just to get them to leave, right? Get them to leave. All right, what does this have to do with prayer? Here's the thing. In the case of God, God doesn't sleep, right? So our prayers, they will never disturb him. In fact, right, our God welcomes our persistent prayers because he wants us to be in continual fellowship with him. Right, and so the point here is if persistency causes a man to react to our needs, then how much more will our persistent communication with God allow God to react to our needs, right? And as we all know, well, sometimes we have not because we ask not, right? You've heard that one before. Sometimes we have not because we ask not. And so in verse 9, Jesus now says this. He says, I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. Now, this is really cool because in the Greek, what this is actually saying is ask and keep on asking. Right? Seek and keep on seeking. Knock and keep on knocking. Right? Because just as it tells us in Matthew chapter 11, God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Right? And that is now what we see in verse 10, as it says there, for everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, the door will be opened. So again, Jesus is encouraging us to be in continual communication with our God, because it's that continual communication that shows God something, right? It shows God the faith and the passion and the reliance that we have for him. And let me tell you, that blesses God. That blesses God. Amen? Now we go to verse 11. And Jesus is going to give us yet another illustration of prayer by asking them a question. He asks them this. Which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will you give him a snake instead? Right? Or in verse 12, if he asks for an egg, who will give him a scorpion? So in verse 13, if you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, then how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? All right. I believe that applies generally. But as we're seeing here, I believe applies even more so when our requests are focused on our spiritual growth. Right? And really, what greater need is there for our lives than to receive the power and the guidance that the Holy Spirit provides for us? Amen? Now, the only problem with that is we don't always want to submit to the Spirit, do we? Right? We don't want to always submit to the Spirit because we don't always want what's best for us. And so, Sometimes we have not because we ask not, but sometimes we have not because we ask for the wrong, stupid things. Amen? We ask for the things that God knows is going to lead us into trouble. So again, right, let's remember this. God is not our genie, right? But God is our Heavenly Father, and He has a pretty good handle on what we need and what we don't need. And that will be as far as we're going to go today in chapter 11. It's good stuff, amen? All right, little review, little quick review. Okay, so to this point, Jesus has been teaching His disciples about prayer, right? And what was learned is that prayer is something that we need to do continually, right? Day by day and throughout each day, because God's our source, right? And He is a source that we can trust and rely on, right? And so as the Apostle Paul said, what we need to be doing is we need to pray without ceasing. We need to pray without ceasing because, again, our God and our Father loves to have communion with His children. But again, God is also very respectful of our choices, which means this, right? That means that He will not interfere where He is not invited. And so you know what God is doing? God is waiting to hear from us. God waits to hear from us. Now, to understand just how much our God desires to hear from us, well, it's the Bible that describes our prayers to Him as being like a sweet-smelling fragrance that rises up to His presence. Our prayers are just a sweet-smelling fragrance that rises up to the presence of our God. Now, I don't know. I think that there may be some of us that have been neglecting our need to pray. I know that is something that I am constantly being convicted of. And as I've been doing this study, I've been constantly being convicted of this, right? But hopefully, after hearing from Jesus today, hopefully that's going to encourage us to get back on track. It has for me. Because prayer is just so important, people. Prayer is just so important to our relationship with God, because it is our relationship with God. Amen? It is our relationship with God. And so as it tells us in James chapter 4, if we want God to draw close to us, then we need to initiate that by drawing close to God. Amen? If we want God to draw close to us, then we need to draw closer to God. And again, that's where prayer comes in. That's where prayer comes in. Anyways, that is the sermon for today. And I'm thinking that was some really good stuff there. Amen? You agree? All right. Well, next week we'll continue on, and I think we'll probably be able to finish the chapter. Pretty confident about that. But right now I'm going to head back by the door, and here's Jason to close in prayer. Love you guys.
So if you'll indulge me for a few minutes, I'm going to kind of tell you where Angela and I came from. Not the birds and the bees stuff. Paul's right there. If anyone's interested in that, he can tell you. So I'm a healthcare worker. We were on vacation in Hawaii, and we missed the quarantine by a couple. You guys heard about this COVID thing, right? It's kind of going around. So we missed Hawaii's air travel being shut down by a couple of days. We were almost stuck there, and we were like, oh, dang. It would have been nice to be stuck there. But we weren't stuck there because that wasn't his plan. It was to plant the seed. We came home. I sat in Bangor, Maine, where everyone was wound up about COVID, but we didn't have it there yet. And I started being convicted that, you know what? People need help. Clearly, somewhere there's COVID. I had the skill set because I'm a healthcare worker. It's time for me to go and do something. So we took a contract, one contract, 3 years ago, a three-month contract in Largo. I was told at our church in Newburgh, Maine, about this little church that might be somewhere near us in Florida called the Salvation Saloon. Our campsite happened to be at the KOA, right there. So we started coming here, and we fell in love. It was kind of like a puzzle, and we were two pieces that just fit in here. Well, three pieces, and then a fourth, I guess. So after that three-month contract, we ended up going to Missouri, reluctantly, loved it. Didn't have a clue, but we had 5 days off, and we jumped in our car, and we came back to our church. 17 hours of driving each way. And then went to Delaware, back to Maine, two more contracts, and I was offered a contract in St. Petersburg. And we were like, yes, we're going back to church. So 9 months of that, I go back to Delaware for, I don't know, was it 6 months? You may hear me call her Chicky. That's kind of her nickname. So it's Angela or Chicky, if I say either. And then went back to Maine for 6 months, and this job opportunity showed up that we did not know existed. In Newport Richey. And it was offered to me. We prayed and decided this was the plan. This was God's will. So I, like an absolute idiot, turned down the job. And I may have upset God. I definitely pissed off my wife because she said, that was the plan. You knew this. We talked about it. It was decided. I went to work the next day, had an overnight shift. It was slow. I turned on a movie, and there were two characters talking to each other. One said, I'm going to have to stand in front of God and answer, when have I stepped out on faith? And I don't have an answer. And I thought, oh, loud and clear, I get it. All right, I get it. So I called them back up and said, you know that job I didn't want? You know how you really want an employee that can't make up his mind? Well, I'm that guy. I'll take that job now if it's still available. And they said, we'd love to have you. So housing's always hard. We had people say before, hey, when are you guys moving down here? We're like, find some real estate. Something we can afford. Housing's always been difficult. And within a couple of days, three places opened up that worked for us. We got a great place. We're super comfortable. It's his plan. That's what brought us back here. We believe this is where we're supposed to be. As the song said this morning that you guys sang, you know, when the Lord's ready, you got to move. And so we moved. Indeed. So one thing we've always done here, I've always loved, is the sinner's prayer. Not every church does it. I personally find it very grounding. So if you want to bow your heads, take off my hat, we will approach the Lord's throne. Repeat after me. Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I know that you died for my sins and then conquered death. Please come into my heart and make all things new. Now, as I dedicate my life and the rest of my days to you. Amen. Have a great week, guys. It's good being here.